For 50 years, the Central Intelligence Agency was the vanguard of America's Cold War against the Soviet Empire. Its heart and soul lay in its ground troops, the men of the DO, the Directorate of Operations. Secrecy was their shield, covert action and espionage their weapons.
They used to call it the Great Game, but it was an extremely serious game of life and death between two superpowers.
You could get killed. It's a dangerous job. If you don't, you'll come home having said it was the best job you ever had.
I said, tell Abu Abbas that I'm coming after him. And when I get to him, I'm going to kill him.
1997 marks a half century for the CIA. America's secret warriors are finally emerging from the shadows to tell the stories of their battles against communism. Today, the agency confronts a new world order, fraught with terrorists, global organized crime, and illegal drugs. It must now pass its most crucial test yet, learning from its past, finding a new role for the future.
The two oldest professions in the world are prostitution and espionage. They go back to biblical times. They've always been done in exactly the same way for centuries. Now, does anybody think they're going to be changed in the 21st century just because the American people don't like the idea?
The body of William Colby, director of the CIA in the mid-1970s, washed up today on a riverbank in southeastern Maryland. A police spokesman said that Colby had apparently drowned while canoeing more than a week ago.
When William Colby died in May 1996, some saw his memorial as the last rites for the CIA itself.
William Colby served his nation as a spy who saw himself firstly as a public servant, especially during that sinister political season we called the Cold War.
They were a brotherhood, a bold and secret fraternity, respected, feared, and reviled throughout the world. William Colby was a charter member who personified its highest aspirations and presided over some of its most brutal failures.
He has been called a soldier priest or a soldier monk, but I would say that the combination of those two qualities makes a very good intelligence officer. A combination of having the moral high ground and an ability to be ruthless when you have to be.
For the secret warriors, the world was the battleground. They were the guardians of the agency's mystique and reputation. A small cadre who fought the covert wars of sabotage, propaganda, and subversion. These were the men of the DO, the Directorate of Operations.
The essence and the soul of the CIA is in the Directorate of Operations. You know, that's what's special about CIA.
The DO is the CIA. Without the DO, the CIA looks like Rand Corporation or anything else.
The Directorate of Operations has become really the president's last centurions. They will march for him, whatever party he comes from.
The secret warriors marched for 9 presidents during the Cold War. Today, their legacy is tarnished and faded. But in the beginning, they were among America's best and brightest. It started with Pearl Harbor. The surprise attack that brought America into World War II should have been no surprise at all. The military had compiled enough intelligence to know that the Japanese were coming, but failed to put the pieces together. William Wild Bill Donovan, a World War I hero and Wall Street lawyer, was brought in by President Roosevelt to head the Office of Strategic Services, the OSS. Donovan's mission was to bring America's intelligence operations under one roof.
He had a tremendous feel for people. He had that knack. He remembered every name. He remembered every scene.
So when Roosevelt gave him the go-ahead to set up this office, well, he wrote to the top university people, to the top banking people, to the top business people, to the top scientists, the top engineers. He got them all to come to Washington. Like a Pied Piper.
To the tables down at Maury's, to the place where Louis dwells, to the dear old Temple Bar we love so well.
Yale University spawned many officers of the OSS and later the CIA. It was a world of establishment ties and secret societies, small elite fraternities that became the model for the Intelligence Brotherhood.
The senior societies are very important at Yale. There was about 90 people out of 700 who graduated who were in them. And they were not all the outstanding people, but they tended to be people who had accomplished something. And it was, I guess, that horrible word, male bonding. But, I mean, you got to know these people very, very well.
We are poor little lambs who have lost our way. Ba, ba, ba.
Jack Northrop graduated from Yale in 1943. From his class alone, 42 men went into the intelligence service. Among the insiders, the OSS earned the nickname, Oh So Social.
A lot of these Ivy Leaguers, the sons of J.P. Morgan and various others, all collected around OSS because they thought, this is going to be interesting work. Donovan's a leader. We'll get in there and win the war.
Richard Helms, a Williams College graduate, played a key role in organizing Donovan's European spy network, the intelligence gathering arm of the OSS. William Colby came out of Princeton and worked the covert action arm of the OSS.
You were dropped into some resistance area, and then you were supposed to bring in more guns and more explosives and so forth, and report intelligence that you learned, help them organize, train them on some of the new weapons that they'd never seen, that sort of thing.
When World War II ended, the United States hoped its victory would usher in a new era of peace. The armed forces were demobilized, and the OSS was disbanded. But Stalin's Red Army occupied Eastern Europe, and the Soviet Empire was taking aim at capitalism around the world.
Here was another totalitarianism, the same kind of threat that we'd faced from Hitler, same expansionist totalitarian power that we had to stand up to. Well, obviously, intelligence is part of that.
Old enemies became new friends as the free world faced the communist threat. General Reinhard Gehlen had been Hitler's commander of intelligence against the Soviet military. He was recruited by U.S. intelligence to head a team of ex-Nazis who were paid to be America's eyes and ears behind the Iron Curtain. It was the first in a long history of unholy alliances.
You never liked to use Nazis, but we needed their information. They had a very good intelligence operation on the Soviet army and on the war, and they've been working there for a long time. I just felt it was a necessary thing. Don't like to kill people either, but you know, if you're in the Marine Corps and you're on a coral reef, you're attacking a coral reef, you don't worry too much about the fact you're killing Japanese to take the island.
The world is tired of political fanaticism.
National security became the national priority. In July 1947, President Harry Truman signed the act that gave birth to the Central Intelligence Agency. The CIA's mandate was to help the President of the United States contain the Soviet menace. When diplomacy or military action was inadvisable or impossible, the President could turn to his secret warriors. Their operations would be hidden not only from America's foes, but also from its elected officials and its citizens. If a covert action was discovered, the President could disavow knowledge of it. This doctrine came to be called plausible deniability.
At Republican headquarters, a tremendous ovation greets the president-elect and the next first lady. A beaming Ike and a radiant Amy. The long campaign is over. The American
When Dwight Eisenhower took office, he brought with him two brothers to run a foreign policy dedicated to stopping communism in its tracks. John Foster Dulles, a Wall Street power broker, took over as Secretary of State. Alan Dulles, a dapper Princeton OSS man with an appetite for covert action, was his shadow counterpart at CIA.
Alan loved the great game. He'd had tremendous experience as a case officer as head of OSS in Switzerland during the war. And he had a tremendous enthusiasm, a great charm. He was sometimes called the great white case officer.
Only months after taking office, the Eisenhower-Dulles covert action program began to pay dividends.
Former Premier Mossadegh's ruined house is a mute testimony to 3 days of bloody rioting culminating...
In 1953, when Iran's prime minister threatened to nationalize British-American oil interests, the CIA took action. A few agency officers hired a local mob to protest against the government. Mossadegh was toppled. The pro-American Shah was returned to power. The Brotherhood had orchestrated its first coup.
The Shah, who had fled to Rome, comes home. Iranian oil may again flow westward.
In Guatemala a year later, it was bananas instead of oil. A popularly elected left-wing government threatened to seize property to give to the peasants. The plantations belonged to Guatemala's largest landowner, America's United Fruit Company. The Dulles brothers, who had close ties to the corporate giant, saw a communist menace looming south of the border.
It wasn't anything but business interest. It had nothing to do with communism. It just had the fact that the government had taken over land that belonged to the United Fruit Company. And they can't do that.
Philip Redinger, a former Marine, was one of the CIA's men assigned to Guatemala. The CIA disguised old American planes to look like Guatemalan rebel aircraft and faked radio reports to create the illusion of a mass revolt.
There were several stations being broadcast, and they staged things like, Colonel, now move your troops over this way, and then Colonel so-and-so, and then try... Of course, they didn't have any colonels or anything, but they would make it sound like there was a regular army invasion. It was a wild... You know, I thought at the time, I said, this cannot work. This won't work. But it did work.
The assault has begun on the dictatorship of Fidel Castro. Cuban army pilots...
The Brotherhood, led by Alan Dulles, was on a roll. But the great game ran aground in 1961 at Cuba's Bay of Pigs. The CIA trained and armed a brigade of Cuban exiles to attack the island in the hope of provoking the people to overthrow Fidel Castro. The ill-conceived operation was a disaster. And worse, the agency failed to conceal its role. There was no plausible deniability for the new president, John F. Kennedy.
As I've said from the beginning, the operation was a failure, and that the responsibility rests with the White House.
Kennedy was livid. Privately, he said that he wanted to smash the CIA into 1,000 pieces. A few months later, he fired Alan Dulles. The man who molded the CIA's mission and mystique was shamed. The Brotherhood was no longer invisible or invincible.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans.
The clarion call of John Kennedy's presidency inspired a new generation of college students.
We had an incredibly large amount of faith in the institutions of government at the time. And within every campus, just about, in the United States, were a number of educators, professors, that were in fact spotting for CIA, for Peace Corps, for anybody, the Foreign Service. And we had an America Incorporated that had a common goal of some sort.
What I saw my life as is advancing the interests of the American people or government in foreign affairs. And really, it was, you can say, as naive and as simple as that.
I can't get over the feeling that I had when I showed up. This was an outfit that had an image that only the best and brightest from the Ivy League schools with tremendous political connections got in the door. And the truth of the matter is, I was really grateful to be there.
I considered the agency at that time as something like and adult Boy Scouts were looking then for young active men to handle their paramilitary operations.
America's young commander-in-chief was also James Bond's most famous fan. Though he had been burned badly by the Bay of Pigs, Kennedy was still intrigued by the possibilities of covert action.
Kennedy brought forth the romance of counterinsurgency warfare to fight this new type of warfare, this secret warfare. And we in essence, where the secret warriors caught up in his movement.
Security of all Southeast Asia will be endangered if Laos loses its neutral independence.
As the countries of Southeast Asia began to liberate themselves from colonial rule, the U.S. government worried that they would turn to communism. A crucial test came in the tiny country of Laos. By 1961, communist insurgents were beginning to make headway against the American-backed Laotian government. Kennedy ordered the CIA to keep them at bay. The secret warriors went high into the mountains to recruit and train native Hmong tribesmen. They would be taught to counter the Soviet-backed guerrillas, the Pathet Lao. One of the first men there was Tony Poe, a hard-drinking Marine veteran of Iwo Jima and Korea. He had also taken part in a daring rescue of the Dalai Lama from the communist Chinese. Some claim he was the model for Colonel Kurtz, the character played by Marlon Brando in Apocalypse Now.
By the old Mulvine Pagoda, looking eastward to the sea, there's a Burma girl a-sittin', and I know she thinks of me. For the wind is in the palm trees, and the temple will cry, all that crap.
A lot of people who were on their way to Laos wanted to work with Tony. He had that kind of a reputation. I was, I suppose, a little bit in awe of him. He was a little bit larger than life.
George, I'm going to give you a...
I was the new kid on the block, and he was a big, strong, aggressive individual and demanded an awful lot of the people working for him.
Do you remember when I first came to know you?
Yeah.
You got off the airplane? Picked me up and threw me back on the airplane.
Did
he really do that?
No.
Yes, he did.
George Kenning got out of college, wanted action, and made the grade in the CIA. He heard about Tony Poe and became his protege. Colin Thompson was an idealistic Yale man who also signed on for the secret war in Laos.
To me, at that age, sounded a lot more interesting than walking the streets in Berlin or someplace. So I went up country, got in my little airplane with Air America and flew up and circled around in the mountains of Laos, waiting for the clouds to lift so we could pop down into Longchang, which at that time was really very primitive. And Tony was living in a tent, really. He used parachutes for his ceiling, and that was very sexy, frankly. We thought that was pretty hot stuff.
To supply the war, the CIA set up its own secret air fleet, Air America. Masquerading as a civilian airline, Air America was manned by a collection of ex-GIs and chopper jockeys. For many of Air America's pilots, Laos was the defining experience of their lives. 30 years later, they still gather every year to relive their exploits.
I don't know what they saw, but the flying saucer went like that. I don't think the F-84s even saw it.
A missionary flying for the Christians in Action, which is the CIA.
Yeah, he said, they're going to kill you. I said, hey, man, nobody kills Tony Poe.
Yeah.
Tony Poe remains their hero, a living legend.
Hey, if I told you some of the things that I did, you say you're a liar. You couldn't do it. I was involved in the most beautiful killing operations of... but I could do it. Because I'm a little bit unconventional.
So they're always asking Tony, well, how do you know you killed so many people? And Tony would basically say, well, that's my word. You don't trust me? You know, send me home.
Hey, the guy is, how many did you kill today? The body count on the radio at nighttime. I had a machine gun section. Well, I said, I've got 8 pair of ears on my belt here. I said, how's that? He said, well, I want to see him.
A plain manila envelope arrives from up country, addressed to Charlie, to Whitey, as he was known, Whitey, and from Tony. And I just happened to be in his office at the time, and he opens up the office, opens up the envelope, and out spill about 2 dozen ears. Yeah.
I think even looking back, if I had it all to do over again, I wouldn't have wanted any other job.
In fact, those days, I jumped a lot even without a helmet. That's probably what's wrong with me now.
Bill Lair, a native Texan who still lives in Thailand, was the CIA's key strategist in Laos. It was Lehr who trained the Hmong to fight the communist guerrillas. He chose Van Pau, a local leader, to head the CIA's proxy army, which eventually grew to number some 30,000.
When they approved to arm the first 300 men, we asked Van Pau to pick a place that was as far away and difficult to reach as possible to give us time to drop the first 300 weapons and to train the people. And I asked him, you know, how long would it take the communists to get up there? Because once we start dropping, they're going to know. And he said about 3 days. So we said, all right, we'll come up with the 3-day training. The communist forces came right on schedule, and the Hmong routed them very easily.
There were early signs of success in Laos, but in 1965, the U.S. decided to pursue a more conventional military strategy in Southeast Asia. Kennedy's secret warriors were overshadowed by Lyndon Johnson's B-52s and American GIs. Bill Lehr saw where things were heading and decided to leave Laos in 1968.
My expertise was in the pure guerrilla warfare and that sort of thing. This was going in a different direction, and somebody else could do it as well as I could. And it was probably better for me to leave because I wouldn't have felt good doing something I didn't believe in.
Many of the CIA officers in Laos were dismayed by the U.S. abandonment of their guerrilla adventure. They left behind 80,000 dead Hmong allies and the scattered remains of an ancient culture.
It was very depressing. Had they continued with the paramilitary type program, it certainly would have been at a far less cost in lives and everything else. In other words, we could have lost a lot cheaper.
Everybody said we lost the goddamn bullshit. The goddamn politicians lost it.
The Brotherhood's secret war in Laos was eclipsed by a much more public war. All eyes turned to a neighboring country, Vietnam. William Colby had commanded the CIA's operation in Laos. In 1968, he was reassigned to Saigon, where he set up a covert action to root out communists in the South Vietnamese countryside. It would become one of the most notorious operations in the CIA's history.
I ran the so-called pacification program there, which was, again, a business of helping the people to defend themselves, with local forces to back them up. I was responsible for handing out 500,000 weapons to the people in the villages in Vietnam. Not to the soldiers, not to the police, but to the people.
Ralph McGehee, a veteran CIA officer, was assigned to Phoenix and soon had grave doubts about the program.
The Phoenix program was based on the concept that the communist movement in Vietnam consisted of guerrillas who were terrorizing the people, forcing them to cooperate, when in essence the majority of the villagers were loyal communists who would dedicate their lives to fighting the Americans. So we were fighting a war in Vietnam that had nothing to do with reality.
Thousands of innocent people were swept up in an operation that grew more and more out of control.
The Phoenix program was a real nightmare. People were being arrested, interrogated, tortured. The Phoenix teams were being sent out to assassinate and capture the leadership of the communist movement.
The Ace of Spades was the calling card for Phoenix teams that killed an estimated 40,000 Vietnamese. For McGehee, Phoenix took a devastating personal toll.
Here was my faith in this wonderful organization I was part of. Here was my faith in my country that I was so proud of. Here was my faith in everything we were doing I was so proud of. It just shattered. At one point, I was sitting in my villa and I was drinking a martini, and I thought, oh my God, I just threw my glass at the wall and it shattered. And I thought about my gun upstairs, that I should consider killing myself.
Ralph McGehee eventually left the agency, and has been an outspoken critic ever since. By 1968, the Vietnam War was bitterly dividing America. So too did it tear at the heart and soul of the CIA Brotherhood. Its unquestioned mission was beginning to unravel. In the 1960s and 70s, Latin America was exploding. The CIA's biggest fear, that Fidel Castro would export revolution, was coming true.
We financed operations wherein they placed bombs in churches in different parts of the country and left behind pro-Cuba propaganda. This would then stimulate enormous demonstrations against communism.
Philip Agee was among the promising young CIA officers helping military governments stem the revolutionary tide. He was stationed in Uruguay, where his agents infiltrated communist groups for the local police.
I was in the police chief's office with my boss at the time, John Horton, and suddenly I hear something strange. It's like a wailing coming through the walls. It got louder and louder and screaming, and then moaning and horrible sounds, and it was quite clear that somebody was being tortured and we were hearing it. I realized what I was working to support, and I didn't want to do that anymore.
In 1969, Agee did the unthinkable. He quit the CIA and decided to write a diary that exposed secret CIA operations. No one inside the Brotherhood had ever broken his oath of secrecy.
It was not enough simply to describe what the CIA does. It was important to neutralize, and I don't mean kill, I mean neutralize the effectiveness of everybody doing it. And that's why I was involved, after my first book came out, in the exposure of hundreds and hundreds of CIA people around the world.
He betrayed everybody he knew. Every person that thought he was a friend or a colleague, he betrayed.
John Horton was station chief in Uruguay, Agee's boss and one of his confidants.
It isn't just a matter of his giving away secrets. He was spoiling the lives and careers of people that knew him and trusted him. Think of betrayal, and I think you can understand how I feel about Agee.
Agee, branded a defector and traitor by the Brotherhood, went into exile in Europe. His book was part of an avalanche of revelations hurled down on the agency as the press began to focus on 30 years of proxy wars and dirty tricks.
In September of 1974, as the book went to the printer, the revelations came out about the CIA's intervention in Chile to provoke the overthrow of Salvador Allende.
President Richard Nixon had ordered the CIA to destabilize Allende's socialist democracy. The agency orchestrated strikes, food shortages, and finally, the coup that killed the Chilean leader. When the story broke in 1974, Congress, fed up with the lies of Vietnam and Watergate, went after the CIA with a vengeance.
The attitude in the White House seemed to be, if in the wake of Vietnam I can no longer send in the Marines, then I will send in the CIA. Inquiry
into the Senate investigation, headed by Senator Frank Church, began to blow the Brotherhood's secret operations wide open. A shocked nation heard about hundreds of covert operations, including one program Richard Helms helped institute back in the 1950s, secret drug experiments.
Reefer!
You know what day it is today, Cap?
Yeah.
What?
Halloween.
What day of the week?
Wait a minute. Don't bug me.
The CIA and the Pentagon had feared that the Soviets were conducting mind control experiments with a new substance called LSD. The U.S. military began its own experiments with the drug, using American soldiers as subjects.
Can't remember.
remember. Come on, man. I don't want this stuff.
The CIA tested unwitting Americans in an operation called MK Ultra. It hired a federal narcotics agent, George Hunter White, to run it. White then brought a bureau colleague, Ike Feldman, into the operation.
He says, we have some mind-bending drugs. And he says, I'd like you to see what they're all about and let me know so I can tell the people in Washington.
The CIA gave White and Feldman immunity to set up brothels to conduct sex and drug experiments. Long before Timothy Leary and the psychedelic 60s, the CIA was running its own acid tests.
I would go to various bars, massage parlors. I said, honey, I want you to do a favor for me. Yeah. I said, I want you to pick up Joe Blow, take him to the apartment, give him a blowjob. And while he's there, I want you to ask him, hey, you know that airplane? How high did it fly?
Hundreds of the agency's most tightly held secrets were revealed in a series of congressional probes. The so-called family jewels were described in detail by its new director, William Colby.
Have you brought with you some of those devices which would have enabled the CIA to use this poison for killing people?
We have indeed.
Colby stunned the country with the most controversial secret of all, the CIA's numerous attempts to assassinate foreign leaders.
Don't point it at me.
One of the main targets of the agency's exotic arsenal was Fidel Castro.
What they wanted me to do was see if I could recruit somebody to get into Cuba to either kill Castro or dope his drinks or do something to make him look like a damn fool.
Have any reason to think that it might say how, if at all, this material was used in an aggressive way against someone to kill someone?
Well, there may well be some of that.
The hearings showed that under the Kennedy administration, the CIA had hatched 24 schemes to kill Castro, including one to infect him with botulism. Another plot involved hiring mafia hitmen to murder the Cuban president. When it was Kennedy, not Castro, who was killed, some in the agency worried that their Cuban operation may have tragically backfired. CIA officer Sam Halpern, who had worked on the Castro problem, was at lunch with his boss when they got the fateful news from Dallas.
All we had from the head waiter was the president had been shot. At that point, we didn't even know he had been killed. And I called for the staff car to come get us to bring us back to the agency. And while we were waiting for the staff car, the only thing that I said to Dez was, I hope it's got nothing to do with Cuba.
In 1978, Richard Helms was grilled about covering up the Castro plots.
Or why didn't you tell the Warren Commission about the efforts to get rid of Fidel Castro or to overthrow the Cuban government?
But, Mr. Dodd, you're singling me out as to why I didn't march up and tell the Warren Commission when these operations against Cuba were known to the Attorney General of the United States, the Secretary of Defense, the Secretary of State, the Assistant to the President for National Security Affairs, the President of the United States himself, although he at that point was dead. I mean, all kinds of people knew about these operations high up in the government. Now, why am I...
Helms was not about to let the CIA take the fall.
Originally, there was a concept abroad that these covert action matters would be handled in a non-attributable way. In other words, if they blew up, they wouldn't blow back on the president or the White House. But all through this period of time, the President of the United States has been aware of and has been approving all of these covert actions.
After the Bay of Pigs fiasco, President Kennedy had authorized a new CIA effort to destroy Castro and his economy, Operation Mongoose.
John F. Kennedy and his brother, Robert Kennedy, who was the Attorney General, were very insistent on having action right away. They wanted what they called boom and bang.
There isn't any doubt as to who was running that effort. It was Bobby Kennedy on behalf of his brother. It wasn't anybody else.
You've heard of the doctrine of plausible deniability.
Yes, and I've rejected it now, Senator. I say that we cannot depend upon that anymore.
The question I was going to put to you is...
The investigations were taking a terrible toll on the agency. Americans were outraged by what they were hearing, and two of the Brotherhood's leaders were set against each other. It was brother against brother. Helms remained defiant, while Colby cooperated.
They were out of the old tradition, we don't talk.
at all, just silent, stonewall. And it was my feeling that that wouldn't work, that Congress had the constitutional authority, and it was a matter of trying to convince them that this was a very valuable agency.
Colby was also pressured to reveal that his former colleague Richard Helms had lied to Congress about the CIA's involvement in Chile. Helms was fined and given a suspended sentence for lying to Congress.
As long as the matter is in the court, I'm saying nothing.
To the end, Helms held to the Brotherhood's code of silence. He became known as the man who kept the secrets.
Certainly, I was secure. I didn't talk about operations. I didn't talk about agents. I didn't talk about things which were legitimate secrets of an intelligence organization. And I kept the faith in these matters. There was no doubt about it. And if that's what they meant by secrets, I did keep the secrets.
Helms and Colby rarely spoke again, and the Brotherhood split ranks behind them. The church hearings were a watershed. Permanent congressional committees were set up to oversee the agency. The president's secret warriors were no longer above the law or beyond the reach of public scrutiny. The glory days were over. It took Ronald Reagan's election to resurrect the CIA. When Reagan named his campaign manager, William Casey, to lead the agency, it ushered in a new era of CIA activism. Like many of the old boys, Casey came out of Wall Street and had been an officer in the OSS. Like his boss, he was an avid Cold Warrior, a welcome lifesaver to a drowning Brotherhood.
Casey liked operations officers. He assumed they were action-oriented.
He loved us. Maybe not wisely, but certainly more than most of his outside predecessors and successors did.
Together, Reagan and Casey revived America's war against communism. They launched their first attack in Central America.
If we do nothing, if we continue to provide too little help, our choice will be a communist Central America with additional communist military bases on the mainland of this hemisphere and communist subversion spreading southward and northward.
The president backed his words with money and manpower. Hundreds of CIA officers were hired. The company was back in business.
Went up and saw Casey, and Casey, you know, said hello, and we talked, and he said, and we talked about the Central American thing. It was the issue of the day. And he said, look, he said, take off a couple of months or take a couple of months and study this problem and then come back to me with a recommendation on what we ought to do in Central America.
The number one target was Nicaragua. In 1979, the Sandinista Revolution, backed by Castro and the Soviets, had toppled dictator Anastasio Somoza and brought a socialist government to Central America. Reagan convinced Congress to fund a very limited CIA operation to prevent the Sandinista Revolution from spreading. Then he turned to his secret warriors.
Believe me, it didn't take rocket science, and it didn't take 2 months to figure out what ought to be done down there, okay? We should take the war to Nicaragua, and we should start killing Cubans. Start making life difficult for the Cubans in Nicaragua, maybe they'll go home. Well, of course, this was exactly what Casey wanted to hear.
In 1981, only a small band of anti-Sandinista guerrillas existed. Then Dewey Claridge came in with weapons and money to create the force known as the Contras.
You got to understand, for Reagan, the Contras were his boys. I mean his boys. There's no way he was ever going to let them down.
As long as there is breath in this body, I will speak and work, strive and struggle for the cause of the Nicaraguan freedom fighters.
People got to understand this. People say, you know, that Reagan was asleep at meetings, so on and so forth. I was in a lot of NSPG meetings, okay? And I never saw that man asleep. Now, maybe he was interested in the subject.
Viva Reagan! Viva Reagan!
Remember one time after an NSPG meeting, he said, "You think you can get your vandals to attack that airport down there when they bring the MiGs in?" And I said, "Mr. President, I don't think my vandals or your vandals have quite got the wherewithal to get down into the planes and attack that airport."
With Reagan's unwavering support, the CIA operation grew beyond the mission Congress had originally approved. The Contras came out of the mountains to attack small towns and ports.
I'd gone in and shot up the port of Corinto to take out the crane, lit the whole town on fire by hitting all the oil tanks, but nothing was really happening in a real sense.
Casey wanted Claridge to pull off something big to destabilize the Sandinistas.
So I was sitting there, and I was drinking some martinis. It was late at night. I was drinking gin on the rocks and smoking a cigar, of course. And, you know, it suddenly came to me that mines was the way to go.
Mining Nicaragua's harbors may have seemed like a good idea to Claridge and Casey, but when news reports uncovered the CIA's role, Americans began to question funding a war against civilians. To the public, Reagan's freedom fighters were looking more like terrorists. In 1984, Congress outlawed all aid to the Contras, and Dewey Claridge was reassigned. But Casey had other ideas.
The director was interested in the ability to go to an existing, as he put it, off-the-shelf, self-sustaining, standalone entity that could perform certain activities on behalf of the United States.
Casey recruited White House aide Oliver North to head up a secret enterprise outside the agency to sell arms to Iran and send the cash to the Contras. Both were illegal. Casey had put the CIA in the middle of another major scandal. Dewey Claridge was one of several CIA officers subsequently indicted for lying to Congress to protect Reagan and Casey.
We were all pawns, many of us, in this fight between the executive and the Congress. In the course of all of this, the President of the United States and many others knew exactly what was going on.
In his 5 years on the job, Casey had revived the agency, but his Latin American operations left its reputation as tarnished as when he started.
In many respects, he was the best director that we had during my 30 years with CIA, and sadly, will be in some ways the worst.
He was probably the leader of the agency that most loved it, or most loved my side of it. But all that said, I'd have to say he was a net loss.
A brain tumor killed William Casey before he was called to account for the worst CIA crisis in a decade, and before he could stake his claim to what may have been the CIA's greatest victory, the defeat of the Soviet Army in Afghanistan. When the Soviets invaded Afghanistan in 1979, the Cold War heated up. William Casey assigned two veteran CIA officers, Milt Bearden and Frank Anderson, to supply and train the outmatched Afghan guerrillas, known as the Mujahideen.
I, like everybody else, believed that ragtag bunches of third world insurgents don't defeat the Red Army.
The initial idea was only to bleed the bear, to make the Soviet war in Afghanistan as costly as possible. But William Casey wanted more.
I was in Pakistan. I saw Casey one time, and Casey said, "Why don't you go win it?" As opposed to, let's go and fight to the last Afghan, or let's just bleed the Soviets. No, he said, go win it.
Bearden and Anderson put together an exotic coalition of Polish, Egyptian, and Chinese arms dealers to equip the fiercely independent Afghan guerrillas.
I told them, look, guys, don't do car bombs. Don't do truck bombs. There's no percentages in it. Let's don't do that. So
They would load a camel up with 150 pounds of Semtex, plastic explosives, and tie it up against a building in this town in eastern Afghanistan, which is kind of like the USO and officers' canteen of the Soviet Army. And when they're all in there sitting around drinking their vodkas and watching whatever they're watching, rip that baby off and blow up 150 pounds of Semtex and a camel and the Soviet officers' club. And they were very proud to get back to me and said, "See, Mr. Milt, we did a camel bomb. We didn't do a truck bomb."
What eventually brought down the Soviets was the U.S.-made Stinger missile. Inside the agency, they debated the future dangers of giving Islamic fundamentalists such a lethal weapon. But Casey's priority was beating the communists, and he prevailed.
A flight of Soviet attack helicopters was moving from Kabul down to this airfield. They stood up, ripped off the first Stinger of the great Afghan war, and it just flew like a great white dart across this blue sky and popped that first helicopter. Second gunner loaded up, and they stood there kind of like a buffalo stand for about another full minute and knocked out three of these guys. Pow, pow, pow.
The helicopter killing Stinger turned the tide in the CIA's last battle of the Cold War. After suffering more than 13,000 combat deaths and a decade of severe economic strain, the Soviets abandoned the war against the Mujahideen. Bearden remembers the day when the last Soviet troops crossed the bridge to leave Afghanistan.
That night, I went home to Pakistan. You could see my office from the office of the KGB resident in Pakistan, and he had asked me on the circuit a number of times. He said, "Mr. Bearden, you must be working very hard all the time because I'm always seeing the light on in your office." And so I kept it on for 3 years just to kind of jerk this big potato-headed KGB general around. And then on the night of 15th February 1989, turn the light off.
The CIA's secret warriors had long dreamt of helping to defeat the Red Army. When Milt Bearden sent the news back to Langley, they broke out the champagne.
"We're poor little lambs who have lost our way. Ba, ba, ba."
When the Cold War suddenly ended, the CIA lost its enemy in the great game.
After we settled into the Cold War, then it did become one big contest between the shirts and the skins. And we were the shirts and they were the skins. And your job was to show up for every match, wherever it was. That's the goal. And then what happened really was that one day they didn't show up anymore.
The fall of the Iron Curtain had taken everyone by surprise, even the CIA. After 40 years on the front lines of the Cold War, America's secret warriors found out like everybody else from television.
I'm sitting in my nice corner office in command of the Soviet East European Division and clicked on remote control, and there it was. That piece of the wall had been knocked over, and people were coming through. For me, it was a moment to rejoice beyond all, you know. And I thought, can you believe that that's done?
For over four decades, the secret warriors did the dirty work for an American foreign policy based on the belief that the Soviets would never reform or change. At their moment of triumph, the CIA faced a cascade of criticism. They had failed to foresee the enemy's historic fall.
The appraisal of the relative strength or weakness of the Soviet Union has always been a political appraisal. It has never been an intelligence assessment, ever, ever, ever. It's only political.
The Cold War was a political struggle between two nuclear superpowers. president made the key decisions, and his secret warriors decided how to carry out the orders. They saw their greatest challenge as subverting and containing communism without letting the Cold War escalate into a hot war.
We did get through this terrible period in which we threatened each other with 25,000 nuclear warheads on each side, and we didn't destroy the world. That's the greatest success. And intelligence played a major role in that.
Along the way, the CIA's secret warriors left their footprints on virtually every continent. They conducted major operations in at least 20 countries, as well as hundreds of smaller covert actions. Nations were devastated, and hundreds of thousands of people were tortured or killed in the proxy battles of the Cold War. At 50, the Brotherhood's days as a small, elite band of crusaders against communism are over. Weary from scandal, contempt of the public, the agency has settled into a vast bureaucracy, its mission unclear, and its future uncertain. The great spy game between the CIA and the KGB was for global stakes. Throughout the Cold War, their agents did whatever it took to find out the enemy's secrets and uncover its plans.
The world of espionage is to go to somebody else's country and break their laws.
You always keep in the back of your mind, how can I use this person?
You're lying all the time. And a lot of people consider that a mark on your character.
When you lie, cheat, and steal, even for your country, it can take a toll.
What espionage is building personal friendships, really close human bonds, and then betraying that friendship when you get that person to do something that's in your country's interest and maybe not his or hers.
In the world of espionage, nothing is what it seems. An ally might turn out to be an adversary, the guy in the office up the hall, a double agent.
You're trying to get someone to betray. A trust. That's what it's all about.
Russian contact was late, and the CIA man was getting impatient, nervous. One hour and three vodkas later, when the contact failed to show, he decided to make contact himself. He took his envelope into the bright spring afternoon and walked the few blocks to the Soviet embassy. For the KGB, it was the beginning of a beautiful friendship. For the CIA, it started a 9-year nightmare. For Aldrich Ames, it was payday.
My intention was, it was a one-time sale to make a quick, illegal killing and stop. Only it didn't work out that way.
Ames was obviously a total disaster, and there's nothing good you can say about him.
He's a killer. Traitor, maybe. Traitor, yes, but he's a killer.
You saw what Ames did to the CIA. The result was an organization that's still reeling back.
Aldrich Ames' betrayal shattered the agency. It raised serious doubts about the CIA's competence and cast a shadow over its future.
What shocked me was that a spy for the Soviet and then Russian government could exist for a multi-year period, almost 10 years, in this agency. Something was the matter here.
Aldrich Ames is more than just an officer gone bad. His case is a window into the world of espionage and into the CIA's unique culture. Though many think of CIA headquarters at Langley, Virginia as Spy Central, ironically, Aldrich Ames was the first CIA officer who was actually spying while he worked there.
He
You're not a spy when you're working for the CIA. You're basically a spy hunter. You go out and find spies.
What we were in the Directive Operations were case offices or operations offices whose duty or requirement was to recruit spies, recruit agents, and then handle them.
The espionage business is a small part of the CIA's huge bureaucracy. Most of the agency's 20,000 employees work in administration, analysis, and technical services. Only a few thousand serve as espionage officers in the agency's Directorate of Operations.
We're watching to see what the Serbian President Milosevic's reaction will be to that.
The job of an espionage officer is to make foreigners betray their own countries, to commit treason.
The fundamental skill is to persuade someone to do something that may not be in his interest.
They use blackmail, ideology, flattery, and almost always, money. These case officers may face grave danger. 59 have died in the line of duty. A more frequent hazard is getting lost in the labyrinth of deceit.
There is a well-deserved fear for everyone to say, the more I behave in this particular sphere of LCS, lying, cheating, and stealing, okay, the more I become like them.
Maybe, in a way, recruiting people and espionage can become addictive. You tend to carry some of the techniques over into your personal life. I mean, recruiting an agent can be like recruiting a girl for other purposes.
It was in this culture that Aldrich Ames was born and raised. Ames is a true son of the CIA. His father, a history professor, joined up in the early years. Carlton Ames' CIA career was undistinguished, marred by his drinking. Still, he passed on the anti-communist mission to his only son, Rick.
It was a crusade. He presented it as a crusade. I tended to, until a relatively advanced age, to agree with most of what my father had said and done, and so I was highly motivated.
Ames started his career in 1967. His first assignment overseas put him under the tutelage of Dewey Claridge, a skilled recruiter.
When you make recruitments, it's just like having an orgasm. When that guy says he'll do it. Just like having a sexual orgasm, no question about it.
Claridge supervised Ames in Ankara, Turkey, an east-west crossroads and a paradise for spies.
I had Ames in Ankara. I tried to get Ames to be a case officer. He couldn't be a case officer. He couldn't recruit his mother.
Unpromising as Ames' debut in Ankara was, the CIA rarely fired anybody. An angry ex-employee might compromise security. The agency preferred to handle personnel problems by keeping them out of sight.
I was the reviewing officer. And as reviewing officer, and I made the dumbest statement I ever made, was this fella really ought to be in the counterintelligence business. Okay? Well, what I meant by that is that this guy has no interpersonal skills. And therefore, what he really ought to be is an analyst in the counterintelligence side of things, where you don't need interpersonal skills. And everybody in the agency or the DO would know that from what I wrote there. Okay? But on the surface, it looks pretty really stupid. Huh?
Stung by Claridge's evaluation, Ames thought about quitting. Instead, he resurrected his career by studying Russian and then joining the agency's Soviet division in 1972. The division assigned Ames to the United Nations, where he sought recruits among the KGB officers working there under diplomatic cover. Jack Platt worked with Ames during this period in the late 70s.
When I met Rick Ames, I liked him because he liked operations. He'd done his homework. He spoke Russian. He'd studied the target. And I had a very successful operational relationship with him up in New York.
In 1978, Ames was commended for his debriefing of Arkady Shevchenko, the highest-ranking Soviet diplomat ever to defect to the U.S. It was the high point of Ames's career. In his personal life, though, he was floundering. His marriage was collapsing, and he was drinking heavily. Once, he left a briefcase full of top-secret documents on the New York City subway. Despite his unprofessional behavior, In 1983, Ames was promoted to a new job in a different area, Soviet Division Counterintelligence. His assignment, to search for spies working against the U.S. Janine Bruckner, one of the CIA's few ranking female officers, supervised Ames briefly in New York in 1984.
Ames came to work for me on a temporary assignment. He committed some security violations there, and I reported him and had him removed.
Bruckner reported Ames for using a top-secret CIA safe house for extramarital liaisons. But back at Langley, Bruckner's warnings fell on deaf ears.
After I reported him for security breaches, he continued to work in the most sensitive job that the agency had.
Though Ames's post as a counterintelligence chief gave him access to top secrets, it carried little real power or prestige within the agency. After 20 years on the job, Ames knew his career wasn't going much further. He began to see things a little differently.
Both the United States and the Soviet Union practice espionage on a mass, on a factory scale. Thousands and thousands of case officers with tens of thousands of agents collecting masses of information, which, frankly, was of very little use to anybody.
In a tiny office on the fourth floor, the CIA was breeding the most dangerous spy in its history. He wasn't a daring swashbuckler, but a faceless bureaucrat. His weapons, papers and files. His cover, a sprawling bureaucracy. Delving into the CIA's extensive files, Ames studied the history of espionage, all the while preparing to make some history of his own. The halls of the Central Intelligence Agency are tinged with paranoia. Penetration by an enemy spy like Ames is its greatest fear. From 1954 to 1974, the CIA trusted one man to protect its secrets. The legendary chief of counterintelligence, James Angleton. The imprint he left on the Brotherhood was enormous.
James Angleton was probably one of the more brilliant people that any of us will ever meet.
Born in Idaho, James Angleton was raised in England. In 1937, he came back to the States to attend Yale.
He was a poet. When he was at Yale, he published a poetry magazine. He was obviously an intellectual person.
Angleton joined the OSS straight out of the Ivy League. In Europe, in World War II, he proved himself a skilled player of the espionage game.
He was a great guy, very odd in terms of comparing him to any other normal human being. He drank like a fish. He would stay up all hours of the day and night. Maybe a mad genius, but he was a genius in many ways. And people forget that he was paid to be the doubting Thomas of everything. And he was.
In the early years of the Cold War, the stakes were high, and effective espionage was vital. In the 30s and 40s, the KGB had recruited American and British scientists who'd given them the biggest prize of all, nuclear secrets.
The stunning news, Russia has the atom bomb, bursts on America.
This is where the role of the KGB can never be underestimated.
General Oleg Kalugin, the youngest KGB general ever, saw early on the significance of the KGB-CIA spy war.
Atomic espionage played a great role in bolstering Russian national security. And this is a fact.
The arrests of the atomic spies detonated a near panic. Throughout the 50s, Americans saw traitors everywhere. For Angleton, the traitors were profound and painful proof of the KGB's skill, cunning, and omnipotence.
He saw this and he saw plots. I don't mean in a crude way, because Jim didn't have a crude mind. But he saw plots. He saw pitfalls. He saw places where we'd been fooled in the past. And of course, if you mention Jim Angleton, you have to remember that he was very close to Kim Philby.
K. Kim Philby was a top British intelligence officer stationed in Washington in the early 1950s. He and Angleton were friends, drinking buddies who talked shop and shared secrets. Later, it was discovered Philby had been working for the Soviets since his university days.
Kim Philby, who I supervised in Moscow for many years, would chuckle over the fact that Angleton had been so intimate with a Soviet spy. I think this closeness and this final realization by Angleton that he dealt with a Soviet spy really changed his character.
That was a big shock to Jim. I don't think he ever got over it, because he and Kim Philby were close. And I suppose you're never the same after you're betrayed.
What is true? Whom do you believe? For Angleton, the answer increasingly became nothing and no one. His paranoia was dangerous at a time when understanding Soviet intentions was crucial to avoiding a nuclear holocaust. October 1962, the Cuban Missile Crisis. It began when the Soviet attempt to build nuclear missile sites in Cuba was discovered by the CIA's U-2 spy plane. What helped end it was crucial information passed to the CIA by a Soviet double agent.
That was an intelligence coup, understanding whether the Soviets were really prepared to go to war or not. And we got that understanding from a human source called Colonel Oleg Penkovsky.
Penkovsky was a senior military intelligence officer, fed up with life in the Soviet Union. In 1960, he volunteered to spy for the West, providing invaluable intelligence about Soviet military capabilities.
It was the information that he supplied which made the president confident that the Soviets, Khrushchev, were not capable of carrying out whatever threats that they were making, and he was therefore able to solve the crisis reasonably.
Washington insiders called Penkovsky the spy who saved the world. Incredibly, James Angleton began to suspect he was a fake. In Angleton's mind, the KGB possessed an almost superhuman power. In 1961, he found a soulmate who confirmed his worst fears, Anatoly Golitsyn, a KGB defector. Golitsyn validated Angleton's theories that the Soviets had penetrated everywhere. Most important, he told Angleton that there was a mole in the heart of the CIA.
You say there's a mole? Yes, yes. We know all about it in the KGB. Well, what's he like? Well, I don't know. I haven't seen his name or anything, but I think it begins with a K. And he was in Berlin, and he was doing technical work because he knew something about the bugging of the American embassy in Moscow. And he's of Slavic background. But here we were. Bang, 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 bang. I was right in the middle of the crosshatch.
Carlo was a war hero in OSS days. He had been with the CIA from its beginning. The young technical expert thought he had a promising career ahead of him. But it was Carlo's misfortune that his name began with a K and he was of Slavic descent. Angleton's great mole hunt was on.
I was on ice for almost a year. And I didn't know why. Finally, I got a call over to the FBI and helped them on a national security project of some high sensitivity. So I got over to the FBI in that old post office building in downtown Washington and walked in. And they read me my rights.
The FBI interrogated Carlo 6 hours a day for 5 days.
They said, there's a high-level penetration in the CIA, a mole, a spy. And we've got to find out who it is, and you're the principal suspect. Well, you know, I was so relieved that it was something as preposterous as this, I laughed. And they said, what's funny? And I said, well, why in the world would I want to become a Russian spy? I have a comfortable life. I've got a nice family. I've got a wonderful wife. I've got good children. I've got enough means. I've got an interesting career, or at least have had up to now. Why should I defect to the Russians? They looked at me seriously and said, you tell us.
Do you intend to answer truthfully?
Carlo was not the only suspect.
Yes.
Dozens of officers were interrogated and their careers derailed. The CIA was eating its young. In 1964, the situation grew even more bizarre. Another KGB officer defected to the U.S., Lieutenant Colonel Yuri Nosenko. Nosenko, much higher ranking than Golitsyn, offered an insider's view of the KGB's upper echelons. Galitzin, who was always looking for a way to promote his own importance, insisted the new defector was a fake. Angleton believed him.
I remember being called into my superior's office at one time and being told that Nosenko, that we thought was quite an acquisition, quite a boon to us, this defector, that he was considered to be sour, that he really wasn't a defector.
They thought he was a double, a plant of the KGB. Had they had an asset within the KGB, they would have certainly found out about that this was a genuine case, but they did not know.
At Angleton's instigation, Nosenko was held in solitary confinement at a secret CIA base. For 3 years, he was interrogated, drugged, and deprived of sleep in an effort to get him to confess he was still KGB. He never did. Back at Langley, a battle erupted over which defector to believe.
People took sides over this. Jim felt that the Soviets are too clever for us. They're sending these false defectors. Anything that they offer us, anything we touch, is going to be bad. And he had immense influence in the agency.
Angleton believed that the KGB was orchestrating a worldwide, all-encompassing manipulation to undermine the West. He called it the master plan.
It presents to the West, by the various themes that it promulgates, what I call a wilderness of mirrors. They can have you believe whatever they desire you to believe.
He believed no one could see through the web of disinformation woven by the KGB. Angleton was so afraid the CIA would be tricked into recruiting KGB double agents that he essentially blocked the recruiting of any Soviet agents. All over the world, the CIA's espionage capability was gradually short-circuited. Stationed in Uruguay in the mid-60s, John Horton found his hands tied.
We had a Soviet embassy in Montevideo. We wanted to work against it, against the KGB and the GRU officers in that embassy. And we were discouraged from doing so. And we weren't told why. We were just told, leave it alone for the time being. This is very hard on operations.
The counterintelligence business lends itself to paranoia. And a certain amount of paranoia comes with the turf, and rightly so. But Angleton went way off the edge.
It developed into, for example, theories like the screen, i.e., the Russian intelligence service is so good, so all-knowing, that what it has managed to do is put a series of false recruitment opportunities out there for us guys in the CIA to snap up onto, and they're all double agents.
Jack Platt was a case officer in Vienna in the late 60s who found himself rendered ineffective.
Officers like me were told, you can try to recruit him if you want, but he's probably a screen. Okay? Don't waste your time. I said, well, what do we waste our time on then? Okay, yeah? You want to recruit bartenders, dancing girls? What? What the hell am I here for if it's all a screen?
Prague. It was here in 1968 that Jack Platt witnessed the real-life repercussions of Angleton's theories. The Czechoslovakian people rose up against the Soviet occupation. But after years of stymied recruitments, the CIA lacked the agents or the information to assess the intent of the protests, or what the Soviet response was likely to be. As a consequence, American leaders were stunned when the Red Army mercilessly crushed the reform movement. Congress later called the Prague Spring debacle one of the greatest intelligence failures of the decade. Despite his excesses, Angleton was a master of agency bureaucracy. He kept files on everyone and used them to consolidate his power. Six CIA directors came and went, while the head of counterintelligence ruled unchallenged.
What Angleton lacked was adult supervision. No one was really supervising Angleton. And I feel that, you know, that Dick Helms bears a lot of the responsibility for this.
Perhaps Angleton's search for a mole was somewhat excessive. The fact remains that counter-espionage is a very important activity. It has to be ruthless. People are going to come under suspicion.
Always loyal to the Brotherhood, Helms protected Angleton throughout his tenure. But another friend of Helms, Peter Carlo, was not as fortunate. Carlo was forced out of the CIA. His 22 years of distinguished service ended under a cloud of accusations and suspicion.
I admit there were times when my vocabulary was extended, thinking of Helms. I also remember the last time I saw him officially in the agency. I went into his office to say goodbye, and he said, well, Sergeyevich, sort of a pet name he had for me, would grow out of something. And I said, I think the humor in that name is sort of dissipated. He says, okay, Peter, he called me, strangely. He said, Peter, I think you'll never know how valuable your service has been to the agency. And I said, that's right, Dick, I'll never know.
Angleton also pursued Soviet agents outside the CIA. Fearing that the KGB was behind the peace movement, Angleton's staff joined the FBI in spying on anti-war protesters. He oversaw another CIA-FBI operation that opened and read the mail of American citizens for many years.
What was your understanding of the legality of the covert mail operation?
That it was illegal.
That it was illegal.
The press revelation that Angleton had spied on American citizens created a furor. He had compounded his problems by suggesting that William Colby, the agency's new director, was really a Soviet mole.
I'm afraid he stayed in the job too long, became overly suspicious of things, and my problem was that I thought that the major chore of the CIA was not to protect itself against the KGB, but to penetrate the Kremlin.
In 1974, Colby called the counterintelligence chief into his office and fired him. Angleton stood by the master plan, which by now his critics were deriding as the monster plot.
I have seen no change in the Soviets at any time.
After Angleton departed, the CIA eventually admitted it had wrongly accused Carlo and other loyal officers. Golitsyn was discredited, Nosenko accepted as a genuine defector. In his zeal to protect the agency, Angleton may have done more damage than any mole ever could.
I'm sorry to keep you out here.
Angleton never found his dreaded mole, but he left behind a CIA so determined to avoid another obsessive search that one could burrow unseen for years. In 1985, despite drinking binges and security violations, Aldrich Ames remained a counterintelligence chief in the Soviet division. The agency was consumed with Director William Casey's secret war in Central America. In the decades since Angleton's mole hunt, the CIA had let down its guard. Ames decided his time had come.
My growing disillusionment was a convenient cushion for me to use. It didn't have a great deal to do with motivating what I did. What I did was an act of personal desperation. It was self-perceived desperation, money.
Ames was deep in debt, paying for an expensive divorce and planning to get married again. His fiancée, Rosario Casas, came from a prominent Colombian family. Ames worried that his $60,000 a year salary couldn't buy a lifestyle that would satisfy his wife-to-be. Selling the CIA's secrets was his solution. His first sale netted him $50,000. Ames had the perfect cover. As a Soviet division officer, he was cleared to meet with Russians to try for new recruits.
I was telling myself there was no risk. You have to understand that. I mean, for $50,000 or $2 million, you don't commit suicide.
Before long, Ames began to worry. There were KGB officers out there on the CIA payroll. Any one of them could find out about him and expose him to the agency. To save his own skin, Ames decided to make a preemptive strike by exposing the Soviet agents before they exposed him. He assembled a 6-pound stack of top-secret documents, describing all the CIA's Soviet operations, including full dossiers on the double agents who might be able to finger him. Stuffing the documents into his briefcase, he headed for the elevators.
I'd conceived of it like someone deciding to rob a bank or something, as a kind of a clever, illegal, desperate ploy, but one that was all kind of manipulable and containable. And having done it, it simply came crashing in on me that I was not in control. And that is what led me in this kind of sleepwalking state into in the end, sort of throwing up my hands and saying I have to go all the way.
He walked out the front door of Langley with a motherlode. Aldrich Ames had gone all the way. Over lunch with his Soviet contact, Ames passed a shopping bag under the table. For a promise of even more information, the KGB contact said he would make Ames the richest spy in history, earmarking $2 million just for him. It was music to his ears. But a few months later, Ames received an ominous report. In Rome, a KGB colonel named Vitaly Yurchenko had walked into the CIA station and defected to the U.S. He was the highest-ranking officer ever to defect from the KGB, and he was ready to tell all.
I got a call to go up to our division's front office, and I did, and he showed me the cables, and as I started to read it, obviously, I was astounded.
Ames understood all too well that Yurchenko might know he was working for the KGB. He would find out soon enough, because he and a colleague, Colin Thompson, were assigned to meet the defector at the airfield and debrief him.
Ames was late. He claimed he overslept. When I saw him later in the day, he looked awful. A typical person who had a really severe hangover. I think that night before Yurchenko's arrival was what really got to him. He's walking out there to Andrews Air Force Base, a military installation, where there are going to be a whole lot of FBI people who can arrest him. They have the power to do so. And he doesn't have a clue what Yurchenko really might have said about him, if anything. He didn't know. And so if that wasn't an occasion to have a few drinks, I don't know what one was.
Ames rode with Yurchenko to a Virginia safe house, not knowing if the debriefing he was about to conduct would reveal his very own treason. In the first few days, Yurchenko identified several Americans secretly working for the KGB. But he didn't mention a mole in the CIA itself. It looked like Ames was home free. The Yurchenko story had a bizarre ending. Hoping for some good publicity, Director Casey leaked Yurchenko's defection to the press. Yurchenko was furious.
It was a Saturday night, and I was literally closing the front door on the way out for a date that night when the phone rang. And I went back into my kitchen, picked up the phone, and this was the security guard. And he was in Georgetown, and Yurchenko just gotten up and left.
Yurchenko and a young agency security officer were out to dinner in Georgetown when the colonel said he was going out for air. He added, "Don't blame yourself if I don't come back." The officer explained later he didn't rush out with him because he didn't want to leave without paying the check.
Freak Tyler. Oh.
2 days later, Yurchenko reappeared at the Soviet embassy in Washington. The defector was defecting back. He claimed he'd been kidnapped and brought against his will to the U.S.
Here, I was kept in isolation and forced to take some drugs. And
Yurchenko claimed the drugs had incapacitated him, that nothing he'd told the CIA was reliable.
Ask CIA officials what kind of secret information I gave them. It would be very interesting for me to know, too, because I don't know.
The story saved face for the KGB. The CIA looked incompetent. The agency had lost a prize defector in a restaurant. Soon, Yurchenko was on his way home to Moscow. As he walked toward the plane, a clue to a far greater disaster for the CIA could be glimpsed in his entourage. Carrying a congratulatory bouquet of flowers was a young KGB officer named Valery Martinov. He'd been called back to Moscow after a stint in the Washington embassy posing as a cultural attaché. Martinov also had a sideline, spying for the United States. 2 months later, Sergei Motorin, another young KGB officer who'd been recruited by the CIA, was unexpectedly called home to Moscow. Then from London, yet another double agent was suddenly ordered home to Russia. The CIA was concerned. Why were so many prized Soviet spies being recalled? No one in the CIA imagined that the answer was in their own ranks. By the end of 1985, every one of the double agents fingered by Ames had been recalled to Moscow, though even they still didn't know why. Some continued to work for the CIA. One, Sergei Motorin, went to a dead drop scheduled by his CIA handlers and right into a KGB trap. KGB officer Yuri Shvets later learned of his colleague's fate.
Motorin was supposed to unload a dead drop in a Moscow cemetery. The KGB surveillance was waiting on this dead drop site for 3 days in a row, day and night. They didn't know who would come. Motorin was caught.
After the KGB arrested Motorin, they threw him into the basement prison of their headquarters, the infamous Lubyanka. For the KGB, Aldrich Ames was both good news and bad news.
I think some wish they would never have a man like Rick Ames. Because to find out that the establishment, Soviet intelligence establishment, was infested with CIA moles was the greatest scandal of all, and Khrushchev barely survived.
Vladimir Khrushchev, the KGB chief, didn't want the traitors to disappear all at once. That might endanger his prize spy, Aldrich Ames, by tipping off the CIA that there must be a mole in their ranks. But President Mikhail Gorbachev and the Politburo ruled no delay. The spies must die.
The guys were betrayed by Ames. This is how they died. They take him into the dark room and then one shot in the head, or the at the back of the head, and he's dead.
We had lost a passel of agents. Bam, bam, kind of like 10 little Indians falling off. And so we knew we had a real problem. So we went to Casey, we got trouble.
CIA Director Casey ordered an immediate investigation and named Officer Jean Vertefe to head it up. The agency had to face the possibility of a traitor in its ranks. It had never happened before, and no one wanted to believe it ever could. The investigators searched instead for communications breakdowns, broken codes, bugged embassies, wiretapped phones. As Vertefe's investigation got underway, word spread through the Soviet division of Motorin's fate.
One day, I ran into Jean Vertefe in the hall, and Jean told me right there. She said they just executed him. He was arrested and executed. You know, she was upset. She'd long been involved with that case. She was upset, and I was shocked. I was upset. And, of course, I said the necessary things to her.
10 Soviet spies were executed, while the man who betrayed them coolly walked the halls of the CIA. The initial investigation didn't find any communications problems. The agency scheduled all Soviet division personnel to take polygraphs, lie detector tests. Ames asked his KGB handlers to coach him on how to trip up the machine. Their advice? Stay calm.
First thing I said to myself was, this is it. But the more I thought about it, it occurred to me that the KGB is going to give me the best they've got. You know, they aren't going to hold back any neat tricks back because they're not worth giving to me. They're going to give me the best they've got.
The KGB's simple advice worked. The polygraph operator judged Ames' answers to be bright and direct.
I think Ames by that time was a practiced liar. I think he could control his emotions very well.
I ran into Rick Ames at CIA headquarters, and we sat down and talked a lot. There was not one thing that I could detect in him personally that would have told me something's changed about Rick. He was clever, he was cool.
Jack Platt didn't suspect Ames, but he was growing uneasy about the CIA's losses in Moscow. He saw what had happened when he tried to recruit a rising young KGB officer, Gennady Vasilenko.
We were introduced by a mutual friend and sort of eyed each other the way dogs do when they first meet, circling around the table.
Of course, I didn't know he was a CIA guy, or I was suspecting that something fishy going around, but that's my job. I was ready for that.
Both officers played the game, each hoping to recruit the other. Then Vasilenko dropped from sight. The KGB had panicked after Ames exposed all the traitors in their midst. Suspicious of Vasilenko's contact with Platt, they threw him in prison.
They don't trust me. They don't believe me. And how you could work like for the service, for the government, you're trying to do your best. Maybe sometimes wrong way, but you're trying. And they think you're a traitor.
The disappearance of his potential recruit, plus the loss of the CIA's double agents, began to add up.
Please, I don't claim to be, you know, I'm the super glorious guy that nobody ever listened to. But you have to put two and two together and say, no counterintelligence organization gets that lucky, historically, without having a guy on the inside. I have no idea who it is, but they got somebody. And if we don't start looking for him, we're just crazy.
You swear, tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
But a political crisis erupted that derailed the investigation. The Iran-Contra scandal sent the agency running for cover. Director Casey was in serious trouble, and the last thing the CIA needed was the further humiliation of uncovering a mole in its headquarters. In May 1987, William Casey died. His successor, William Webster, was not even informed about the loss of the Soviet agents.
The disaster that occurred to Soviet operations went largely unnoticed by the outside world. It just sort of fell off the back of the stove for many years.
With the heat off and the KGB money rolling in, Ames could indulge. He bought a new Jaguar, designer clothing, jewelry for his new wife Rosario, and a $500,000 house in the suburbs, which he paid for in cash.
I cannot imagine that somebody didn't start wondering how could he possibly do that and then take it very seriously. And they didn't. I guess they didn't. I'm just every time I think about it, it gets a little more mind-boggling.
The CIA ignored other clues that something was amiss with Ames. On assignment in Rome, Ames was picked up drunk in the streets by the Italian police.
I know three women reported him to the chief of station. He was their supervisor. He was drunk all the time, and they didn't pay attention.
His drinking took a toll on his work for the KGB as well. Once, he became so confused about where to meet his KGB handler that he flew to Zurich instead of Vienna.
Well, I was never a big steady drinker. I mean, all I know was that certainly I had trouble controlling my drinking at various times and over a long period of time. What it really all comes down to, I don't know.
As Ames was sleeping off his liquid lunches, the ground was shifting under his feet. The Soviet division, now run by Milt Bearden, was re-energized by the changes rocking Eastern Europe.
We are rolling. We're working. The Soviets have left Afghanistan. The Berlin Wall has fallen. The Czechs have gone. By 1990, the Warsaw Pact slips beneath the waves. It's over.
The Soviet Union was self-destructing. KGB chief Kruchkov, the spymaster Ames trusted to protect him, was struggling for survival. On August 18, 1991, he led a coup to overthrow Gorbachev.
то первым, кто учинил заговор против государства союзного, это был Горбачев.
The coup collapsed. Muscovites stormed Lubyanka, chanting death to the KGB. Khrushchev was thrown in prison. Soon, the Soviet Union was no more.
I was overjoyed at the failure of the coup. This, of course, it was a matter of some apprehension for my own personal security.
Ames now found himself in the unusual position of being a spy without a spy master. He didn't have a country to work for, but that didn't stop him. Instead, he started selling secrets to the new Russian government. After 6 years, the CIA still did not know for certain they had a mole. The possibility conjured up so many ghosts, from the excesses of Angleton to the excuses of the last 6 years, that the agency was incapable of investigating itself. Finally, in 1991, the CIA called in its arch rival, the FBI. The FBI drew up lists of likely suspects. Aldrich Ames was on every list. The FBI trailed Ames, put surveillance on his home, tapped his phone, checked his finances, sifted his garbage. The circumstantial evidence that Ames was a spy was overwhelming.
By that time, I was in a pretty advanced state of denial, which involved denying to myself that there was any tangible threat to my discovery. I was just denying that to myself across the board.
February 21st, 1994. Aldrich Ames was scheduled to fly to Moscow the next day. After a three-year investigation, the FBI was not about to risk a defection. That morning, as Ames was driving to Langley, eight FBI agents stopped him and pulled him from his car. He was told he was under arrest for espionage. His response? You must have the wrong man. After $2 million, 10 lives, 3 presidents, 4 CIA directors, the end of the Cold War, and many, many stiff drinks, Aldrich Ames still couldn't face what he had done.
One thing I worried about and I wondered about, you know, why didn't I wake up at night sometimes, you know, not so much fearing that I would be caught. Why didn't I wake up at night feeling as guilty as I thought I should about what happened to some of those men? And I don't know what the answer is.
The Ames and Angleton stories bookend the Great Spy War, the obsessive mole hunter and the mercenary mole. Both men were products of the secrecy and deceit that come with the business of espionage. Both damaged the CIA for years.
I believe that James Angleton created a backlash, such an anti-counterintelligence atmosphere inside the agency, that what you end up with is no capability as far as I'm concerned.
He did things, a lot of things he shouldn't have done, but basically I think Jim was right. As a matter of fact, during his period of 20 years as the head of counterintelligence, we never had an Ames case, at least not that we know of.
Aldrich Ames is now in federal prison for the rest of his life.
What I sold to the KGB and the Russians didn't make a damn bit of difference to anybody, except in the human terms, where it made a great deal of difference. And that tells you something about what's really at stake. It tells you that espionage really is not very important when you come right down to it. When you look at the record 40, 50 years of spy wars and you say, well, what have we got here? And it's pretty much garbage.
Aldrich Ames compromised hundreds of CIA operations and scores of officers. His betrayal was a severe blow to agency morale and to its already beleaguered image.
The only thing I'd like is 5 minutes alone in a room with Rick Ames. Anyone who has been involved in a career of espionage must understand that throughout history, there have been double agents. There have been betrayers. There will always be a Benedict Arnold somewhere.
In a moment, you will hear about the arrest of Jim Nicholson, a 16-year career CIA Director of Operations employee on charges of committing espionage for Russia.
Only weeks after Ames was caught, a higher-ranking CIA officer allegedly followed his example and started selling secrets to the Russians. Harold Nicholson stands accused of betraying the agency for money like Ames. Unlike Ames, he was caught in 2 years rather than nine.
Thus far, we have no information that any CIA assets were killed as a result of Nicholson's spying. It seems unlikely that the damage he caused in any way approaches that done by Ames.
The spy wars of the Cold War have outlasted the Cold War itself. But the stakes have changed. It is no longer a great game of life and death. Despite Ames, the CIA won the spy war with the KGB, but his betrayal deeply scarred the Brotherhood's legacy.
I think that the Aldrich Ames case will be the point in time that one can always refer back to that was the beginning of the end, or the end of the clandestine services, the DO, as it was constituted for close to 50 years.
In the lobby of CIA headquarters, there is an inscription from the Bible. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The goal of espionage is to uncover the truth. But in the wilderness of mirrors that is the Central Intelligence Agency, the truth can be hard to find.